So we're going to read God's word this morning. The Bible reading was not in the reader's one. That's because, well, I guess initially I didn't put one in just because I forgot to really put one in. But secondly, because I didn't have one at that time. And while you're flitting through the Bible to find Hebrews 12, which in my church Bible is page 1210, 1210, maybe slightly different than yours. Just to say that Reader's One, the new one is available. They should be scattered around on your chairs. If not, there are some on the table at the back. They are there for the next 3 months-ish, next 12 weeks anyway, starting from next week. And again, just encourage you to read those words. There's normally a little question, a little challenge somewhere on each of the weeks for you to think about, pray about during the week. And certainly after Easter, we're going to head back to Revelation for a couple of weeks. And then we're going to go back to some real basics after School Sunday. School Sunday is on April the 17th, as I was just reminded this morning. But after that, we're going to go back to some real basics of belief in God. And I hope that it will not just be something basic that we'll go, oh yeah, but it will be something that will really challenge us to understand who God is in our own life, who we believe He is, and perhaps also to have an understanding of other people's thoughts about God that we might be able to kind of discuss and share with people because of that new understanding perhaps that we'll get out of this new series coming up in April. So that's all in Reader's One. Don't jump ahead, just use 1 week at a time. They're using the Bible passages there, and read it every day, that we might be reading together God's Word. So, Hebrews chapter 12, before we read that little passage, let's declare what it is that we're reading from. I hold God's Word in my hands. It encourages, corrects, and instructs me. Lord, speak to me now. So these words, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endures such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Before we go any further, as I was reading that passage through again this morning in the office, I was thinking about, you know, the last 7 weeks, well, previous 7 weeks where we looked at these seven letters. And quite often, not in every one, but in most of those letters, there's been kind of the plus and the minus, if you like. And I was just looking through this little passage of three verses and kind of thinking the pluses and the minuses, so to like, of that passage. And I don't want to spend a huge time on it, but it's another way of doing the Bible study. The sun's come out, my little miracle there. I haven't underlined it, underlined probably all the ones that we could stop at, but here's the thing, pluses and minuses, or what appears to be a plus and is a minus, or what appears to be a minus and a plus. Okay, so keep open that local passage, just read through it and see if you can pick out any minuses or pluses or things that might be a minus but actually are a plus and vice versa. So I'm not going to spend a great deal of on it and debate about it, but if you want to shout out something as we go through, and I'll pick out the ones that I am blind as well. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, sounds a bit plus to me. I've been surrounded by a great crowd of witnesses. Cloud of witnesses. Let us throw off. Plus or a minus?
Plus?
When you throw off something, can be a minus, but actually, when you throw off something, especially if you're running a waist or something and you've got something holding you down, and it talks about entangling, then it's good to throw that off and get rid of it. So that can be a plus. Everything that hinders, plus or a minus? The thing that hinders is minus? Minus, yeah. Yeah, let's do this or that, yeah, okay. Things that hinder you, you need to throw off, so yeah. The sin that so easily entangles, good to a sin, like entangles, again, things that entangle us. Minus that one. Let us run with perseverance.
Yeah.
Plus, perseverance. We had perseverance in one of the letters, didn't we? Already. The race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus. The pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. The cross. Now you see, if we go back 2,000 years, the cross would have been at least up until Good Friday night or Sunday morning or whatever.
We're post-Calvin, not pre.
Well, yeah. But I mean, you know, for a lot of people, the cross is the same. When we're down the High Street, if we kind of just portray that Jesus died on the cross and leave it at that Good Friday morning, people are going, But the cross for us, now we're living after that, is very much a plus. Scorning its shame, the shame of the cross. I mean, being nailed to a cross was seen as a huge shame then. Sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition. Endured. From sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Not growing weary, not losing heart. And so I just was sitting down this morning at the desk and just thought of that and just underlined it. And another way of doing a little Bible study. And you don't think of plus and minus ways, but just highlighting a few words, just stopping at a passage and kind of thinking about each word. What does that actually mean? Is that good? Is that bad? Why does it apply to this passage? And just doing a little Bible study. And you can do that with every passage that we're going to look at this year. Not necessarily say good and bad, but just kind of stopping and reading the word, kind of thinking, that why is that word there? Is that relevant to what's said before? Or why was that word put in? You know, okay, it's just another way of studying the word. Okay, so here we are. We have spent a couple of months looking at these seven letters, remember, dictated by Christ to seven churches in southwest Turkey. And I don't know about you, but I've been fascinated to read through those seven letters, to study them in preparation for coming here on a Sunday morning. I found them informative, interesting. It's been good to hear Joe Stoll's take and kind of taking us to the actual town in present day use or not in repair or ruin, but to kind of be there and get an idea of the location and so on. I know a number of you have found the series challenging. And it's a good thing to be challenged. Every week it's a good thing to be challenged. It's definitely a good to be challenged. Because, you know, when you have been challenged over the last couple of months by something that's been said, something that's been written in those several letters, it means at least, that the Holy Spirit has been nudging you, prompting you, giving a little poke, kind of saying, hey, you know, you need to be doing this, or moving on, or you need to be putting that aside, because he's wanting us to sort of take some action. That's what happens when you get challenged by God's word. How many of you were challenged over the last couple of months as you read God's word? Yeah, I've got my hand up. Okay. And that's good to say, because you felt God's Spirit moving you. And that's wonderful. And even if the challenge from the Lord was not what you wanted to hear, which sometimes it isn't, you should still kind of be excited. You should still be excited, because it means that God is actually stopping, taking some time to say, hey, you personally, I'm challenging you to take a step this way or that way, or to do this or not do that, or whatever. Take fresh steps of faith. So it's good news that you're being challenged by the Lord. Now, of those who were challenged by this series, those of you who were kind of nudged by God's Holy Spirit, who's done something about it? Hands didn't go up so fast, did they? And that is... That is sometimes the issue. We can come on a Sunday, or we can be reading God's words during the week, and you kind of think, oh yeah, Lord, really? I mean, I've had a number of people over the last 2 months, as well as other times as well, and I'd love to go back and ask the question of the person that said it to me. That really challenged me. I really felt the Lord was speaking to me on that day. And so I'm kind of going back en masse today, if you like, and kind of saying, okay, if the Lord was challenging you, have you actually done something about it? Because if he's challenging you and you're kind of saying, yeah, that was a good challenge, that was, I like that, yeah, that was really good on that day. Don't think about it, well, no, but I really felt challenged. Right. We need to action that. Because the Lord is kind of poking us by his Spirit and saying, you know, you ought to be doing this. Then we ought to be doing it. Not putting it off. Not waiting for the next challenge. Okay, so I said right at the beginning of the series that we would add another letter to the seven, sort of. That in other words, we would stop and consider, what if Christ dictated a letter today to Highfield? What if a messenger came flying through the door now? I've got a letter for you, I feel, dictated by Jesus Christ. I wonder if we'd grab the person and say, oh, great, let's have a look. But let's kind of think about that this morning for the next few moments. There's no right or wrong answer. And we don't know what Christ would write to Highfield. So I'm not kind of second guessing the Lord this morning. But what I wanted to do really, as we've been thinking over the last several weeks about kind of the strengths and the weaknesses of these seven churches, kind of look at the strengths and the weaknesses of us. And that's a very good practice to do in any organization, in any group of people, to stop and kind of look at the strength and the weakness. What often happens, particularly in churches, but in other groups as well, is people pick up the strengths. Oh, we're good at, and we'll do that in a minute. but they kind of don't really pick out the weaknesses to actually want to do something about them. The only time they pick out the weaknesses is through a complaint or a moan. Mm. And that's kind of a real negative, because it's not kind of, well, we want to do something about it, you know, well, that doesn't happen, does it? You know, or this person doesn't do that, or our church doesn't do that. Or, and it's kind of just a groan and a moan without actually any positive moving forward. So I want us to look at our strengths and our weaknesses this morning. Just a very quick reminder, just to get our head round each church that we looked at. I've just highlighted a couple of lines for each, so I haven't necessarily picked out the whole thing. Ephesus, they were busy, hardworking, perseverance was a word there. They sought out the truth. They all the right things in the church was going on, but remember, for Ephesians, for the Ephesus church, they had forsaken their first love. They were not in love with Christ as they once were. So that was their strength and weakness. Smyrna, they were rich in their poverty. Rich in their poverty. And they were going to go through some hard times. And they were encouraged to be faithful through that. Pergamum, there was evil all around them, it seems, and yet they were the ones that remained true when all that was going on around them. But it was often about them. Some claimed to be Christians and yet carried on living as anyone else did in town. They were calling themselves Christians, but you couldn't tell the difference between a Christian and anybody else in the marketplace. Thyatira, small church, they had love, they had faith, they had servant, they had service, and again they had perseverance. And they were doing more than they did at first, so they were growing. But they tolerated false teaching. They let it ride unchecked. They kind of knew what was going on, but they kind of outgrew. Sardis, the alarm bells went, remember the alarm bells going. Sardis, the church had a reputation for being alive, a great reputation. People around kind of said, that's the live church. And yet the Lord said, excuse me, actually, they're dead. There's a hardness, there's a coldness inside. And what you're showing to people is not what's really going on. And Christ keeps saying to them, so three times, wake up. Philadelphia, a small number in the church. And yet remember the doors of opportunity that were there. Little church, but opportunities were opening up for them, and they needed to go through those doors. Laodicea was the last one that we looked at. Not a great deal good about Laodicea. Lukewarm. And Christ said, I'll spit you out the mouth. But he did say, I'm standing at the door and I'm knocking. You're going to open the door and let me in. So that's the seven churches. So now the letter to Highfield. It is only, if you like, an imaginary letter from Christ, because we cannot discern what Christ would actually say to us. But what do we kind of think that he would say to us this morning? Let me... Then a line down the middle. Let's put. The other way around. Oops. So let's look at some of the things that we are. We'll do the strengths first. I shouldn't put that way around. We'll do the strengths first, because that's how the Lord often works. So strengths.
We're talking about a church in poverty.
Yeah.
We haven't got a lot of money.
No.
But we're always forward thinking. And in deacons' meetings, we're never held back. We're always thinking, right, we need to do this.
Optimist.
Sorry?
Optimist.
Optimistic, that is the word.
Okay. So, terrible pain, if you just start with that, don't you know? That will summarise it. Lack of kind of financial resources, yeah, we are financially poor in that sense. And yet there is that real sense of moving forward. I don't know any other church. I may find one Monday, that I've been part of, or that when I talk to other people about, where you know you go to a deacon's meeting and you come away excited nearly every time. You know, if I tell some ministers that, they kind of go, "Please can I come to your church?" I don't quite say that about me. But there is a real kind of forward thinking. Yeah, this is what the world wants to do. Doesn't matter about finances. You know, we're not in a numbers game, but it's finances or people, I suppose. And then it's just, this is what the Lord wants to do, we'll do that. So there's, yep, that's good.
Helpful.
Sorry?
Helpful.
Helpful. Yep, offer of help. Why have I suddenly gone into capitals? Offering help to people when someone's in need, yeah, we're quite often there to help people, whether it's here or whether it's abroad, or whatever. We get a bit of kind of, yep, we'll run with that, we'll help, we'll raise some money, we'll send out Bibles, we'll whatever. Yep.
Welcoming.
Okay, yep. Quite friendly.
Like Philadelphia,
Sorry, Mari.
Like the Church of Philadelphia, we keep plodding on.
Right.
Persevere.
Like the Church of Philadelphia. Like Steve was saying that earlier on about Philadelphia. Sorry.
I'm not here in half that's going on.
So. Yeah. that was what you were saying to me at the back. You weren't.
We have a large. Well, yes, the majority of our congregation have a strong, solid faith.
Right. So, a sense of perseverance, we keep going. That is very true. There is a good foundation there, a solid faith that isn't shaken by things that go on perhaps around us or even within us at times. Yeah, it's good.
I believe within the church we have a true fellowship, there's a true concern for each other.
Bonding, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to quickly go to my ones in case I am. I've got perseverance. I've got family, inverted commas, so there's that sense there, yeah. I put On mine, I put good heart, which is probably in a lot of those things. But the other thing I put was, I'm not going to come out really solid. Mission-minded. I think we really are. You know, although again we're small in number, there is that real sense that we are mission-minded. A number of people outside of Highfield have said that as well, that you are kind of a mission church, that we want to reach out to people, and so on.
No,
we'll keep as we are.
Yeah.
Okay, that's quite a good list there. So, lack finances sometimes, and resources, and yet we're still forward thinking. We offer help to people, whether that's physical help, or whether that's again financial help, or some other way. We're welcoming to people. Persevere, keep on going through things with solid faith. There is a sense of fellowship and bonding. Always helped, I think, in that, because it is a smaller number of people in the church. So we have that sort of family bond in that sense. We're not necessarily all like in the same house all the time. You have to be like aunts and uncles and nanas and granddads and so on. But we have that link. We have that, you know, keep in touch with people and make sure everyone's okay and so on. So that's good. And mission-minded. But we do really look out. Certainly over the last few years, you know, with things that we're doing, even giving away of gifts, and Messy Church, and getting people in on school Sunday, and all those kind of things, mission-minded. Yep. So, then comes the weaknesses. Some of them, I've already noted in my head, kind of tie in with some of the strengths. You may not see that, I don't know. We'll see how we go through. So, what do you think is kind of our weakness? Let me prerequisite that and kind of say, weaknesses are not always a bad thing. I know my weaknesses, and it's good to play to our strengths sometimes and not to our weaknesses. And that's not to say that my weaknesses can't be stronger, or I shouldn't get rid of some of my weaknesses. They shouldn't be fixed, because some of them should. But sometimes our weaknesses are just, it's all right, it's a weakness, but I can work to my strength. And again, as a church, sometimes, you know, every church is different, and some of them are stronger in some things and weaker in others. The weaknesses don't always mean that it's a fault that needs to be rectified. It just you need to be aware of it so that we know that that is a weakness. But we can sometimes play to our strength, or sometimes we have to fix the weakness. So, you know, weaknesses can be seen in two ways, right? So, I don't want you kind of thinking, you know, if I say this weakness, it's going to be a terrible thing, it's going to look bad, and so on. It doesn't necessarily mean that. So, I give you that prerequisite. So, what are our weaknesses? And don't say you don't have any, because we do.
I'm struggling how to phrase it, and I'm not pointing the finger at the church, but at myself. You asked a question earlier on, have you found the letter challenging? I said yes. So if you were looking at me, you said, what have you done about it? Well, I have done nothing. So from my point of view, there's a lack of total commitment, I guess.
Right. Yep.
I like what's going on in the church. It's a good idea, I'm committed. But
yes, I would agree with that, as a church, and I think probably most of us can say at some point, as Highfield, that we're in that boat. You know, yes, all these things are good, yeah, and we like to do this, and we like to do that, and we want to see things happen and so on, but I think there is a lack of total commitment. You know, we'd already said solid faith, absolutely. I've got a problem with that. We said moving forward, absolutely. I've got a problem with that. But I think there is, in general, perhaps a lack of total commitment. Now, that's not unique to Highfield. they're going to think you're probably right. We don't always kind of sign up and go, yep. It's, yeah, it's a good idea. Like that, they move. So, yep, I agree with that one. You're about to say something else.
Like Keith, I'm trying to phrase it.
Just say it.
Yeah, take the limelight off me, for goodness sake.
Go on.
I think with an eye on our mission mindedness, that I think our mission or evangelical voice, our presence, could be louder, could be more common.
Right.
I don't know how that can be addressed.
No.
It may be through media, maybe getting in contact with people working in local journalism. They might be interested in the opinion from the church's point of view. I don't know, but a louder voice.
Personal boldness.
Sorry?
Personal boldness.
Personal boldness. Maybe there's a link there. Yeah, even to the extent of someone going, okay, I'm definitely going to take one of those eggs this morning, and I'm definitely going to go knock on my neighbour's door, and I'm a bit scared about it, because I haven't actually spoken to this neighbour for years. In fact, they make so much noise, I'm really fed up with them, but if I'm honest, but I'm going to knock on the door anyway. Personal boldness, that's just one example, but yeah. Anybody else? I'm very aware of that within our church. Fellowship, bonding, but if people aren't around too much in the fellowship, then they do tend to get forgotten. I probably don't even have to give examples, you only have to think yourself. People within the church who counts, Highfield was their number, perhaps what we haven't seen for a while, kind of get left off the bonding. Certainly people that have come into the church sometimes in the past and visited have kind of been very welcoming and friendly to them. But if we haven't seen them for a couple of weeks, we've perhaps forgotten.
Just to give an example of how it works when you do.
The following up of people, just by encouragement to those that are here this morning. If we do ever get a visitor, actually we're going to get a lot of them in a few weeks' time, it's called Sunday, but that's almost overwhelming. But nonetheless, if you're sitting next to somebody and they're a visitor, or someone walks in and you kind of feel, yeah, I ought to say hello to them. There are welcome packs on the table. More importantly, inside each welcome pack, there is a little card. And what is lacking, and I admit it, I've done this myself every time, I think, in the little card, is to take it out and say, look, this is our welcome pack, you take it home, but there's a little card here. Could you just fill out, I know it's personal details, but could you just fill out your name and telephone number or an address or an email or something, so at least we can contact you again if we want, we need to. And it's kind of that connection, because what's happened is we give out those packs, we don't ever take out the card, they go home, and we never see them again, and we've got no way of contacting them, because we never take their details again. So, you know, that's real basic connections with people that we perhaps are lacking in there. Anything else?
Well, I think if we were going to be brutally honest, we could sit here having a whole list of personal shortcomings, and we're coming down to personalities.
Yeah,
I mean, it's absolutely personal.
I
think it's good to look at where we could go, what more we could achieve at a church, but let's reassure ourselves that for a small church, we achieve an awful lot. And by that, I'm going across all age ranges. I'm not just talking about those who are able-bodied and turn up to as we did the other day, to shift heavy rubbish out into skips. Not everybody is able to do that. We must recognise that. But I've been specifically encouraged over the past few months it comes up in idle conversation, not idle conversation, it comes up in casual conversation. And it sticks in here. I hear about what people have done just casually with neighbours walking across the room. So I don't rule out any age group at all. I think our senior members are an encouragement, our younger members are an encouragement, which is why I come to this church, because of the fellowship, because of the perseverance, because of the positivity, because of the solid faith. But let's not rest on our laurels.
Well, I'm going to finish this list off that I put in. I just put down the word. Inviting. Interesting, again, you know, we do invite people, we do send out, like Messy Church just said, you know, in goes around and drops cards into people's letter boxes and so on to encourage people to come. And so on, and I know you do invite people to things. But again, we looked at 18 months ago, I don't know, somewhere around there, about, you know, we all invited five people, two or three would probably say yes to something, and we could, you know, double our number. How many of us, don't put your hand up, how many of us actually go around and actually invite to Messy Church? How many of us say to our friends, our neighbours or whatever, hey, let me take you over for a coffee at the coffee room at the church? How many of us say to perhaps some who used to go to church, or you kind of discern that perhaps had some church connection in the past, hey, why don't you come with me to Highfield or something? And again, perhaps we need some little invite cards for you to use. Although we have got postcards which you could write on the back and invite someone to it, just say, you know, this is our service times, so love you to come, I'll knock on your door if you like, and take you with me. You know, you don't have to come on your own. Or come over for a coffee, you know. I'll treat you. It's all a 30p. You know, if we all go into the inviting mode, and I think that there is a weakness there. There is a weakness probably in every church. So it's not always just us, it's not always just a bad thing, we need to just be encouraged to perhaps take steps. But if we all went out inviting, we kind of said, this week I'm going to invite so-and-so to so-and-so. And the next week you say, I'm going to invite so-and-so to this. And it means you coming as well. I know, you know, if it's a coffee morning, you need to invite them along and say, I'll come with you on Tuesday morning and whatever. And it just introduces people, it gets people onto the premises, it gets people mixing with other Christians and so on. And the more we invite, the more are going to say yes. You know, someone that you gave a pen and notepad to a few months ago, what about forming out now and kind of saying, hey, I think you fancy coming over to our coffee morning once, so yeah, I'll treat you to coffee and toasty water. It's going to set you back one third of you, but it's going to Okay, I'll come over. Is an important follow-up, an important thing, but I think we, as well as a lot of other people, are fairly weak at. So, we've got straight, definitely good, and we should praise God for those, and we should encourage each other with those. We've got weaknesses, nothing wrong with weaknesses, everyone's got weaknesses. But again, some of those we could say, actually, remember the challenge, hopefully. We could say, maybe I should be taking some actions. Maybe as a church, we should be taking some action. So that we kind of follow this through. And some of those weaknesses become stronger. And who knows, if we did this a year's time, some of these things would be over here. Yeah, we're good at inviting people. We're good at following up people. Because a year ago we thought about it and were challenged by it, and now we do that. So, you know, weaknesses, as I say, aren't a bad thing in themselves. They can challenge us. Some things are kind of, well, they're not so important. You know, we need to major on our strengths. And that's very good. Some weaknesses we kind of think, yeah, but that's our challenge. That we follow that up in the next few months and do something about it. And then we can become more fruitful for the Lord. So never be down on weaknesses. We've all got them. And, you know, it's part of our humanity, it's part of us being a church even. Every church in the world has weaknesses. Even Jesus' little gathering of 12 disciples had their weaknesses. You know that. And Jesus still used them. So don't be down on our weaknesses. We can't be everything. We can't do all things. But we need to be aware of them, which is why we risk them out. And if it's important, we need to perhaps follow that through and start to gain some strength in those things to fix the problem. In the week, my mind went to our church calendar. Some of you have got a church calendar at home somewhere, pinned on a board somewhere, or put in a Bible somewhere, or whatever. And my mind went to the church calendar, and the verse that I felt the Lord was giving me the end of last year to put in the church calendar. Anyone remember what the verse is? Or where it comes from, maybe? Actually, it's quite hidden on the calendar, on the actual verses. It's from Proverbs 2, verses 5 and 6. And it says, just to remind you, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. Lean not on your own weaknesses. In all your ways, submit to him, and he, will make your paths straight. So, there's what we're strong at. There's what we feel are our weaknesses. It's good to recognize them, but we need to move forward. That's our strength, moving forward. Go on then. We're loving. We're loving. Fellowship, bond. Loving. Thank you. Corinthians 12 and verse 10. The Lord gave me that this morning. Very long story short. I was listening to a message with Ali last night on YouTube. One that she said she'd heard before, but I hadn't. And then I picked up some of it this morning on the way up here as I walked up here. And I just felt, wow, that was just where the Lord was leading. 2 Corinthians 12 verse 10, I delight in weakness, says Paul. For when I am weak, I am
strong.
You know that one, don't you? In other words, when we know that we are weak in things, we need to rely on God, not ourselves. We need to rely on him and not ourselves. And back to our kind of living. Trust the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. Submit to Him. Rely on Him. And He will give us the strength to go through and to develop and to be a strong ministry for Him. Thank you for that. And I realise time has flown. Maureen.
In all of the churches at the end,
yep.
One thing it gave it a promise.
Yes.
Have we given that as our promise for today? Because from our strength, we can see that our Lord is our provider.
Yes.
And He is faithful.
Yes. Thank you. Yes. There was always a promise in there. And I think that probably did come through, well, I guess from the calendar and also from that reading that I was given this morning from 2 Corinthians. That sense of God is there to strengthen us. He's always there to strengthen us. I will always be with you. And in weaknesses, we are made strong through Him. But we need to rely on Him. And you know, our biggest thing that we need to do is probably to fully rely on God from
Lord.
And if we do that, He will make us strong in the areas that we need to be strong. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. We were going to sing that, and I had it on a video clip. But looking at the time, I think we better move on, because we need to come around the communion table this morning.